Are you?
Hey, everyone,
I am.
And welcome to episode one of the Geek Access Podcast. I am joined today by my two co-hosts, Corey.
Hello.
And Brandon.
Hello.
And we are also joined by our special guest, Kyle.
Hello.
And we are here today to talk some shit with you. We're going to be discussing some video game news, some movie news, talk about a little bit of the upcoming E3, and just hang out with you for about an hour or so. So we'll go from there. Corey, what have you been up to this week?
Lately, I've been playing a lot of Among the Sleep. I want to get more delved into that. Just playing as a little baby and being horrified, just, I love it. Just something with, I don't know, makes you feel really young when you're playing it, especially when you got good little headphones on.
Yeah, I heard a little bit about it. You're like, you're 2 years old, right?
Yeah, you're 2 years old.
Yeah, and your light source is what, a teddy bear that you have to squeeze?
Yeah, it's a little teddy bear that talks to you. He's kind of creepy, too. I kind of iffy on him. I think he's out to get you.
How does that work? I assume there's no combat in the game, right?
No,
it's more of a slenderish kind of thing where you'll be out doing, trying to get to a certain area, and there's going to be keys or a little item you'll need. And there's a creature, like where I'm at, it's a really foggy swamp area, and this thing comes out of the water. And I was trying to open a door once, turned around, and I straight up jumped. I threw my mouse on the floor.
No,
but it's pretty
good.
I like it.
I actually beat that game. It's a kind of short game. It's still, I think, really well done for the Kickstarter and what they did for it. And it's short, but I like the atmosphere. You do play as a toddler, and it's a very different perspective of, you're scared and you don't know whether or not it's the child's vision or this is really going on. So it's really interesting.
Yeah, I agree.
So what's the premise behind it? Like, is there a reason you're a two-year-old, chasing after shit? Or is shit chasing you? Like, what's bring me into the game. Like, what's going on with
basically, first scene... You're in you're having a birthday dinner with your mom, and somebody comes to the door, and so she leaves. And when she opens the door, you hear yelling, and your vision gets very blurred and distorted, and you feel weird kind of as a baby. And then she slams the door and takes you to your crib. And that night, something happens where your teddy bear gets taken out of your crib, and then the crib gets thrown over, and you're outside of the crib, and you're trying to find your mom, and your mom's gone.
So it's, sorry, Kyle, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, the premise is that, you lost your mother, you get awakened by this ethereal, force, and your birthday present was a teddy bear, and it talks to you, and then you pick it up from the washing machine, and it says, we have to find your mother, and it starts the quest of, we have to find your mother, something's wrong. So.
Interesting.
I dig it.
Very cool. Yeah, I'll definitely check it out. Brandon, do you have any experience with it? Or?
I played the alpha way back when and liked it.
Yeah.
So it was, I think three people made it. So it's pretty good for that considered.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
Is it $19.99?
$15, I think.
Yeah,
I think it's on sale for $15 this week.
$19.99. All right, cool. All right, well, if anyone's interested in checking that out, I'll make sure we put a link to it in the show notes. And also, I assume it's right on Steam. Is it available on any other platform, or is it a Steam Greenlight?
It's just
It's a Humble Bundle. It's on Humble.
Oh, it's on Humble Bundle as well?
Yeah.
Yep.
Very cool. Very cool. All right. What have you been up to this week?
Oh, working, playing out Watch Dogs since that just came out, and getting back into League of Legends.
Nice. How's Watch Dogs going for you?
It's not what I expected, but I still like it enough. It's turned out to be basically Grand Theft Auto meets Assassin's Creed, but I wanted more of a third-person Deus Ex, but I still like it for what it is, and it's a pretty good open world, and the multiplayer's been pretty awesome, too.
I've enjoyed it. Now, Kyle,
you can, I like the invasions, the Dark Souls-style invasions.
Yeah.
I've enjoyed those. Now, Kyle, you've played it too, right?
Beat it.
Oh, you beat it. Of course you did.
Yeah,
well,
I binge things. It's really bad.
That is my goal. That is my goal for episode one. My goal is for one of us to mention a game that he hasn't beaten yet.
Oh, okay.
So. We'll just have to find obscure stuff.
Yeah, I've
we'll
got
a sports game.
Yeah, great.
I don't play those.
How do you beat a sports game?
I am, I mean, I don't want to have any spoilers for it, but I know it's a brand new game. But yeah, I've met the hacker. I just did the cemetery mission. I'm really enjoying
that's,
it.
That's actually where I am.
Is it okay? I'm finding myself getting distracted by a lot of the sides. Constantly getting jumped in on my game. I've actually also enjoyed the CTOS tablet app. It's really fun to fuck with my friends while I'm not at my console using that app and chasing them down with the helicopter.
Does it let you target your friends, or does it you just have to randomly get them?
You control the helicopter by touching on the tablet.
Right, but can you choose to get into their world?
Yeah, you can do quick play, or you can add people to the app using either the using either, what is it called, the Uplay name, PlayStation Network ID, or I believe Xbox Gamer Tag. So that's the thing about the app is it's not a second screen, it's a standalone app. So even though I have the game on PS4, I could still invade you on PC because the app stands alone.
Yeah. Right. Well, it's like the companion, yeah.
Exactly, yeah. So I've really enjoyed that. I like it, man. It's a non-ghetto Grand Theft Auto. I really enjoy that.
Non-ghetto.
Well, there's no rap. There's no, like, stupid... I don't know.
You don't play a gangbanger.
Right. I've been caught a couple times this week saying it's the smart man's GTA.
See... I mean, I liked the game. I liked the gameplay, but I liked GTA story and multiplayer and like infrastructure better.
Right.
But it's one of those things where, they're two different games, even though they're both open world. Right. You know? And I'm from Chicago, so it was.
Oh, go ahead. You're from Chicago, and oh yeah, you were telling me that, like how it's not. It's similar, but it's also different enough to where it's frustrating.
Yeah. A lot of the core landmarks are still there. Like, you know, you have the Sears Tower, you have the Bean, which in the way they rented it, it was like a cube thing. I just sat there. I'm like, no, what are you doing? It's a round bean. I worked there for 4 years. I was going to strangle somebody. So
this isn't Chicago at all.
Yeah.
Got the architecture wrong. I'm going to strangle you.
I read up on it that, you know, they made 40 trips to get the feel of Chicago. They got the feel, I'll admit it, they really did, but the layout of the city and where things are placed just drove me insane. I'm like, if I go down this street, I should hit the highway. There's no highway. What is...
you can't use your physical roadmap, huh?
Yeah.
Now, do either of you have experience with Heavy Rain?
Yes.
Oh, I actually have played and beaten that one. Got the perfect ending, too.
Do the cutscenes feel like Heavy Rain cutscenes to you? No, not at all. Where I really felt it was the scene at the grave. Maybe because it was raining, but I just felt
I think it was just the rain.
No, the quality
was it raining heavily?
Is that high?
Yes, it was raining heavily.
That's right. I think it was just you.
Yeah, but I am excited for Heavy Rain 2, which is still rumored for PS4.
They're actually doing that.
Yeah,
I'm ready for E3 so I can hear something about The Division.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. They're not going. Right. Wait a second. I thought they were not going.
I think they're going. They've already delayed it to 2015, but I'm pretty sure they're going.
Yeah.
So.
Well, we have another E3 absence that we're going to be discussing a little bit later. I don't know if you've heard about it, but Square isn't going to be talking about Final Fantasy 15 or Kingdom Hearts 3 at E3 this year.
Well, that's okay with me.
Because you like indie games, which is why you play League of Legends.
Sure. Kingdom Hearts, man. That's where it's at.
Yeah. Kingdom Hearts is great.
Yeah, no, man. Especially now that Disney has Marvel and now that Disney has Star Wars, I really hope they incorporate. Like, I don't know how long KH3 has been in development, and it might have been in development too far back to incorporate those IPs, but, I mean...
It's been, 6 years, I think, right?
Yeah, and we'll be waiting, another 15 years for Kingdom Hearts 4, but... I would love to see Marvel and Star Wars incorporated in the Kingdom Hearts.
A little cartoony Hulk in Kingdom Hearts. That'd be great.
It'd be a lot of fun.
He's like one of those summon things. You're like, oh, Hulk smash! Yeah.
That'd be awesome.
So good.
It would indeed. All right. Well, last but not least, we've got Kyle. Kyle, what have you been up to this week?
For gaming wise, I did Among the Sleep. I finished Watch Dogs. playing Minecraft and, you know, Dota, there's not really too much that has kind of piqued my interest. The Forest has, but...
Yeah, I was going to ask you just now if you had played The Forest, because I'm intrigued as well.
Yeah, I know a bunch of people from, like, B-Team that have it, and they said it's really great. The premise and the alpha is fun, but it's just, it is an incomplete game. It's version, like, 0.2, right. So...
I think with multiplayer, it would be really good.
Yeah, that's the next thing. But I guess the overall concern I have is still, like, all these early access, you know, games, and some of them are great, like The Forest or everything like that, but you also have this huge, like, difference or span where you also have, like, that World War Z thing?
That was terrible.
Yeah, I bought that, and I just wanted to... Yeah, I flipped out, so...
Well, there's this one, too, that I just saw on Steam called Lifeless Planet, which looks kind of interesting.
Yeah, they all look interesting, and they all want your money. So
I want your money.
Yeah. You know, I'm pretty good. That brings up an interesting topic, and I want to kind of get your guys' opinions on it. Do you think that, as a gaming culture, do you think that we're getting too many of these, hey, my game is 10% done, so give me $30? Like, do you think that's becoming too much of the norm? Like, that's almost the new free-to-play model. Like, for a while there, free-to-play was really popular, and it was like, all right, we'll let you have access, but we're going to nickel and dime you. Now it's, well, we're not going to nickel and dime you, but we're going to charge you full price for a game that may never get completed.
Exactly. And yeah, I mean, that's, I think that we've swayed too much against that, where we're buying things that we like. We're an impulsive culture. Like, as gamers, we're like, oh, we want to know. This looks awesome. And that's biting us now.
Right.
You know?
It totally is.
I mean, you got Minecraft. Most people out there. You had Minecraft, which was like that, which pioneered the system, but you also have, you know, like, all these others that are doing it, that, like, Infestation. I mean, it's a great idea for small studios to do it, like, was a Transistor came out, and that game was fantastic. I played that.
Well, Supergiant did Bastion, too, so.
Yeah, so.
You knew that was going to be
good. Bastion was great.
Yeah, Bastion. Mm-hmm. I think the narrator was some of the best.
Oh, yeah.
Of course. Oh. And he just went around smashing things.
Oh, I love it when, like, I was just fucking around with the character, and if you run him off the edge in, like, the very first level, he totally goes off to you.
Oh, yeah. I think I remember doing that myself, actually.
All right. Well, cool. So that's kind of what we've been going over for the week. It seems to be there. I mean, have we missed everything? Anyone else have any interactions or any experiences this week, aside from Corey getting punched in the eye?
I have been playing a guest access for Wildstorm. A friend of mine gave me.
Have you? How's that going?
I like
guest
it.
Access
Wildstorm, the new MMO.
Oh.
The new WoW killer.
I think I may buy it. It's been pretty fun. I'm only like level 3, but I like it so far. There's like a ton of different ways you can build your class and all that. Like, tons of things. I don't even know about. I'll have to follow up on it, but. I like it a lot so far. I think it has a lot of potential to be an MMO I will pay for.
Yeah. I'm actually at the leveraged part with that too. Derek, a person we mutually know, bought it, and he's saying, you should buy it now. I'm like, I don't want to lose my life in an MMO.
You should get one of the guest passes from him, because I'm given to understand every copy comes with a guest pass, like a couple guest passes.
Like, wow.
So you should do that, because I like it so far.
Hmm.
So well, how is it? Like, is it your typical WoW clone, or are there similarities to WoW? Is it that typical questing system? What's, like, the class system? Because that's been tried, like, so many games have tried to change it. Like, Guild Wars 2 tried to change it with the item swapping. Final Fantasy 14 tried to change it with your item is your, or your weapon is your class. Like, what's the basis behind it? Because I haven't seen it that frequently.
So there's like 5 classes. I'm forgetting the names of them right now. There's like Warrior, Engineer, Esper, Spell Sword, and I think there's one other I'm missing. And you also can pick like a path, and there's like Explorer and Scientist and 2 others. And it seems like your path gives you a separate set of like side quests you can do in zones to like level up your path. I still really don't know much at all. It's really something I'm still new in, and I'd like to follow up with once I've spent more time with it. Like, I really want to get into it because I like it a lot so far.
That sounds actually awesome. I mean, let me know what you think. I might pick it up. I'm on the fence as well. So
there, when I was looking at like the quote talent sort of tree area, there's like a ton of different skills you get in like 4 different categories for your class. And then there was also this huge, like, they called it the amp board that had like at least 100 different things that looked like they were separate skills or like attribute boosts. So it seems really customizable and pretty in depth. So I'm fairly intrigued by it right now.
Yeah. Nice.
I mean, yeah, I mean, what I've been doing instead to get my MMO fix is playing Dark Souls.
Well, I still pay for WoW because I'll never stop paying for WoW. But
see, that's what I was gonna say, because it is $15 a month, right? Mm-hmm. And see, like, the only thing I'm paying monthly for right now is WoW, but that's at that. I mean, we're going on a decade of that, so that's at that point where, like, I just incorporate that into my bill budget.
Like, it's in mine too.
Yeah, I'm not gonna get that. That's cost of living for me.
That's right.
That's a necessity. No. Oh, come on, man. I mean, we won't make this a Blizzard podcast, but Warlords of Draenor looks so amazing. Item normalization, the new character models. I'm pretty excited. That gets covered in a million other podcasts, so I'm not gonna go over that time and time again. Plus, I think everyone that cares knows everything about it so far. But
that's right.
So excited, but yeah, WildStar. I think for me, it's more so at the moment. It's free time more than it is financially. Plus, I mean, I'm not sure how I feel about the graphics. I don't like that bright, cartoony.
It's very Jack and Daxter-y.
Oh, is it?
I so like
I've
that.
Only, I've only seen screenshots that could have very been from early beta.
Artistic direction-wise, it's very Jack and Daxter-y.
Okay, yeah, because I hear that early beta was very different from what we're playing right now. Like, a lot of people didn't like it in early beta that are loving it right now.
Well, that would make sense. That's why they do betas.
Yeah, true.
Yeah. See, yeah. As Blizzard fanboys, we get spoiled because their betas are other people's final releases.
That's right.
That's a good point.
It is a very good point. Yeah. Cool. So WildStar. All right. Well, before we break into the next thing, everyone keeps saying Dark Souls 2, so we got to talk about it. I haven't played it yet. I enjoyed the first one, but I thought the first one was just, it didn't feel like much of a game. It just felt like it was hard for the sake of being hard.
And you were doing it wrong.
Definitely was. I'm
flipping you off right now.
You were doing it wrong. You were absolutely doing it wrong.
It felt like I was playing a more advanced version of, if you've ever played Infinity Blade on the iPad.
Oh,
yeah.
Like, it's a really cool slash game. It's kind of fun, but the story is really dumb, and I don't give a shit.
You're doing it wrong. Something incorrectly.
The story is great. I agree. You need to doing search it wrong. For the story.
Yeah, I mean, did you play any of From Software's other games, like Armored Core? They had a couple other things, but like, was it Demon Souls? Was awesome.
Yeah, Demon Souls.
I didn't like Demon Souls as much. I had a solid 100 hours in a Dark Souls, but Demon's Souls I didn't care for much. Yeah. I think Demon's Souls just controlled very poorly was my problem with it.
Oh, no, that's exactly why. Dark Souls was basically Demon's Souls Controls 2.0, but
that's right.
You know, for what it was fantastic. The story was great, you know?
Right. Once you got into it, you never got past, like, how far did you even get into Dark Souls, really?
Maybe the third or fourth boss.
Did you even get the Drake Sword, that thing that's supposed to help you throughout the whole start of your game?
For me, the Xbox clan, the Xbox clan that I was in, it was hype. It was Dark Souls. And then I picked it up, and I'm like, this isn't that special.
I don't know why you feel that way.
I don't know. So
I don't think you probably got far enough. But it's why it's so special is that it's a solid, like, combat system with a really good story, and like, it's all laid out. Once you figure it out, yeah, the stuff's tricky. Like the stupid jump thing where you press the thing that kills all the time.
Right. But,
in a sea of games that are too easy, it was actually a challenge.
Yeah.
See, that I
and it's nice.
That I agree with, but I need to. Difficulty is difficulty. I need to feel like I'm doing it for a reason.
You know, like, what I progressing? Mean?
Yeah. And in a game like that, like, if I'm going to play an item game, I'm going to play Diablo 3. So that's not enough to draw me into it. I need the story. I need to want to see what's going to happen next. And if I don't feel compelled by that, then I'm not going to care. You know, yeah. So anyway, so now, okay, so Dark Souls 1. So Dark Souls 2, what does it improve? What does it build on? Are there any flaws with it? I do know that the PC port's still a little broken as far as if you try and use keyboard and mouse, but I guess if you use controller, it works great.
Yeah, it's controller's fine.
Only way to play, man.
Well, yeah, definitely.
Only
way they to also play. They fixed the graphical issues.
Oh,
I've played a meager few hours of Dark Souls 2 so far.
Oh, you need to get into that one, man.
Free time.
I'll admit I'm the stupid one. I bought it for 360 because I wanted to play it right away. And then I bought it for PC right after. And I gotta say the difference is huge. Like graphically, it's obviously they actually imported the high res. They did all like the optimizing. They did it like in Dark Souls when they ported it. It was a sucky port to PC. Everyone knows
it was
that.
Terrible.
You had to mod it to get it to work. And Dark Souls 1 had a great community. I mean, actually, one of the reasons why I played and bought Dark Souls was it like the Prepare to Cry series? Somebody showed me to that, and it's a great way of introduction to this, like the story and why everyone has different motives, as well as speculation. So, but the controls are tight. I'll admit the story isn't as good. Period. I wasn't. As
no,
intrigued.
It's not.
So, but the gameplay was, and the combat was fair. The gameplay was upgraded, and lots more bosses because they had lots more money.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
Right. I just want to pause for 1 second. The people that are watching on Twitch, I'm watching the chat room. If any of the audio levels are off, if you could let me know. I did just get a text from my wife who's also watching us on Twitch, and she said that I was coming in a little bit low. So if you guys are having a hard time hearing me, again, this is episode 1. So I'm just trying to get everything adjusted. So feel free to tell me I suck at running my mixer in Twitch. You won't hurt me. All right. Well, we have that taken care of. All right. So, it sounds cool. Now they don't have it for, next gen, right?
No, which is sad. I really wanted to play it on the PlayStation.
Right.
Yeah.
But what are you going to do?
Yeah.
Was it, they said that, basically, when they realized that they were going to try to get to the new hardware, they said it's too late in the development cycle. So they just said, screw it.
Right.
PC it is. Awesome.
Yeah, I mean, I've got my Xbox 360 controller, so we'll see how that goes.
I would suggest if it's on sale, definitely pick it up. Because we played Watch Dogs. We all played Watch Dogs pretty much. And like the invasion system in the PvP is, you know, Watch Dogs used it, but it's great. I love that for... You know, you can still be single player, but you can have the feel that there's other people there.
Yeah,
well,
like with the blood stains and the messages
in your
shit.
World.
Yeah.
Yeah, the bell towers. Ugh. Hate the bell towers. They'll just randomly spawn on you repeatedly. You'll have like 3 guys on you at once, and they're all real people, and you're just like trying to run away. You're like, no, please, stop.
Yeah.
Is when I first started Dark Souls 2, when I got to the town, I didn't go to the cemetery where you're supposed to go. I ended up in that tower with all the giant knights, and I thought that was where I was supposed to go.
Hyde's Tower, yeah.
I had a bad time.
Yeah, those guys are a little bit, they're big.
I had a bad time.
Yeah, in Dark Souls 1, I got so frustrated for the first hour because I went into the cemetery and you fought those like auto-regenning skeletons, and I threw a little bit of a hissy fit. I'm like, I kill you every time, and
back.
You know, so
just gotta find the little guy, stupid guy with the lantern.
I mean,
I think, right?
That's why I'm actually confused, Nate. Is that you love fantasy? I know you love fantasy more than sci-fi. So,
oh yeah, definitely.
Like Dark Souls is a great dark fantasy, you know, world that you expand upon, and that's why I'm actually really surprised you don't love Dark Souls.
Yeah, maybe it's just something that I need to.
Sit down and enjoy, like really engulf yourself in it, and you'll appreciate it. I'm sure.
See,
once you figure, because you gotta go ahead.
I was gonna say the problem is that there's just, and again, this is the same with WoW. There's so much that I'm playing right now, and I think that's really what's gonna drive me from it. But you know, like Kyle said, it goes on sale, Steam summer sale. I'm sure it'll be up there.
Oh yeah.
So I'll pick it up for $3.
$3.
I have the opposite problem because I blow through games. I'm just like, done. I'm like,
right.
Well,
I wish I had that problem. I don't have that problem anymore.
Yeah, my problem is they come out too much. See, that's when you're married and you have 2 kids, you don't just blow through a video game You play it for like 6 hours on launch night, and then you don't get to play it again for about a week, and then you're like, wait, what the fuck's going on? Okay, I'm just going to play WoW.
Yep, that's right.
Oh, yeah. I'll admit, ever since I dropped WoW or MMOs, I play a lot of other games. I mean, right. So it's one of those things. But you know, I was in WoW. All of us were in WoW for like how long? And I just decided to drop the crack. I'm done. Just
right.
No more.
Drop the crack.
All right. Cool. So let's see here. So all right. Cool. Well, that covers it. All right. Well, let's go over some stuff that kind of caught our attention this week. I know you guys talked to me before the show about some things we wanted to talk about. I'm kind of curious, and I want to fight with Corey. So, Corey, let's start with you. You were talking to me about Spotify and iTunes and whatnot. So inform us and inform the listeners what you were talking about and why I'm still going to think iTunes is better. But let's go.
That's fine. You can still think what you want, man. I love Spotify. I use it every day at work. It is the greatest little app. You can basically what it
am
is.
The only one who uses Pandora, I guess I am.
I used Pandora until iTunes Radio came out.
Yeah, I used Pandora until Spotify came out, and I've used all three, iHeart and Spotify and Pandora. And I'll admit, Spotify is great because you can pinpoint your songs.
Before that, I was the only one who used Last.fm. So.
Yeah.
Last.fm, I remember that.
It was good.
No, yeah, it worked. But Spotify, for $10 a month, you can look up whatever song is in your head, name, artist, whoever, and find it, and you can put it on a playlist, and you can have that with you at any time, even if you're offline. Like, you can have the physical song with you, and you just have to make your playlist playable offline, and you can bring it anywhere, which is great, because if you don't have any Wi-Fi, and you're like, oh, I can't listen to Pandora, you can just flip your Spotify on, and you'll have your whole playlist right there for you.
Right.
And you can share those playlists to other people, and they can download them for themselves.
Okay.
Which is super nice. And for $10 a month over going to a radio station and finding something that you might not necessarily want to listen to, I'd rather listen to this one thing I want to listen to every time than having to hit next 13 times.
Yeah, I can understand that. That's one thing that I will say about iTunes Radio as opposed to Pandora. Which is one thing I actually miss, is that with iTunes, with Pandora, if you nixed a song on a playlist, it was nixed for that playlist. So, like, if I wanted to, like, with my country music, for example, you know, I like upbeat and I like slow country. Fuck off.
Terrible.
But if I'm like at work or whatever, I don't necessarily want that to mix in. So I can nix it for like an upbeat country playlist. Let me have a full country playlist. With iTunes, if I nix a song, it nix it for my account. So that is one thing I enjoy about that. Now with Spotify, as you said, it's downloadable. So you're not streaming.
No.
So how does that work with the, like, I assume it's a more limited library compared to like an iTunes or a Pandora, because I'm sure there are less artists and recording studios that are willing to let you do that.
Right, but slowly and slowly more people have been jumping on the Spotify train.
Okay.
Yeah, I also heard that they do like if a new song comes out, they'll do like a limited duration thing where if you release like you'll have like a week where you can listen to like a new song or something like that. For an artist, but I stopped using it once I stopped sitting at my computer like at work at Wells Fargo for like 40 hours a week.
Right.
You know.
So yeah, so that's all right, so that works. So what so you're a Spotify guy? You're happy with that?
Yeah, cool. Totally happy.
Brandon, you're a Pandora guy.
That's right. I
will forever be my Apple fanboy.
Well,
Kyle, I guess Kyle, I'm going to assume you use something that's provided on a Samsung phone.
No, I actually. a problem is that I want to move over from my iPhone, but
right.
iChat is
why
an issue.
Why?
Because it's a terrible phone.
Because no, it's not.
Apple locked products, locked into their services. They screw you over. And I'll admit, with like the Yosemite, whatever, their recent like reveals.
Yosemite.
Not part of the cult.
Yosemite.
Yosemite.
It's okay. There's a tech podcast that I listen to, and someone fucked it up for you. They called it Yosemite.
That mountain, okay.
Yosemite, yeah, so, Sam.
Yeah, whatever. The name element is kind of stupid too.
You're gonna get shot in the ass by a midget with red hair tonight for calling it Yosemite.
He is, isn't he?
Yeah, but I mean, I liked their products are sound, but I don't have as much faith in the company as I used to, and you know, all their reveals weren't that great either.
It's because it's the same thing.
Exactly.
As an Apple fanboy, I will say that it has gone
Kool-Aid.
Yeah, no, it has gone downhill since Lord Jobs has passed away.
That's what happened.
Thank God he died.
No, he was the salesman. No.
Yeah.
Wozniak was a smart guy.
There are things that happened that are great that Jobs didn't want to happen. Like the iPad Mini was a great idea, and Jobs was against making a 7-inch tablet. But there are also things like the innovation is gone. I mean, I went from a 5. I actually went from a 5 to an S3. I was coaxed into getting an Android phone, and I really hated it. I had it for about a week and couldn't stand it, and I couldn't wait until I was able to get another phone. So I waited, and I ended up getting the 5S last year, and I'm actually pretty excited for the – I don't know if it's going to be the 5XL or the 6 or whatever ends up coming out this year. My big thing with the developers conference was I was disappointed in the lack of the announcement of the iWatch because I was really looking forward to that.
Smartwatches, I don't.
Those are so dumb.
Yeah,
you look like a douchebag with one of those things.
Exactly. I mean, yeah. Google Glass are called glass holes already. I mean, you don't need a smartwatch.
Yeah, and once Apple comes out with a glass, I will be a glass hole.
So,
actually, Google's looks really cool, so I might try Google's. But
I keep hearing like it's not worth it. From multiple places.
They're only supposed to be like $299.99 when they launch. Right now, paying $1,500 for it's ridiculous. But there are more useless things that you can buy for $300, like a Nintendo
Wii.
Or
an iPhone.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I mean the Nintendo thing. Mario Kart 8 is selling fantastically. But
it is.
As I said before, they're still functioning at a $256 million deficit for the year.
Right.
Not to
cut you off, but Corey, you were giving me a crazy number. What was the sales up? You gave me a sales percentage a couple days ago.
Yeah, I go to N4G a lot, but on N4G they said that from the release of Mario Kart 8, their console sales have gone up like 666%.
Yeah.
It's like, Jesus.
Mario Kart's the devil.
Well, but the problem is that
every kid wants it.
Yeah. Yeah, and every parent will buy it for their kids. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I mean, they just laid off a bunch of people in I think Germany. It was 190. They shut down like the Germany Nintendo studio. Yeah, and they're just like, you know, they've got to start, you know, putting out more games and making more revenue because they've been in the red for 3 years. I mean, I love Nintendo. But
they just need to jump on the third party train because they don't have anything. They're just trying to make all exclusives.
See, I don't think that's the secret. I think the secret is they have to jump on the licensing train and they have to give us a Mario game and a Zelda game for PS4 and Xbox One. I think they need to go the Sega route.
Well, look at Sega.
Yeah, I think it's too late though. I'll be honest.
But Sega's properties were never that wonderful. What did they have? Sonic and Echo the Dolphin?
Hey, yeah. Echo was badass, all right?
It was actually a pretty fucking morbid game.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it was creepy.
Yeah, but, I mean, and Sonic was great, but those trailed off in the same way that Mario games are trailing off.
Yeah, but then they originally duked it out. Like, yeah, consoles were the big thing, but they both duked it out with handhelds, and Nintendo was holding on to its laurels forever. Like, 3DS.
Oh, they still dominate.
Crazy. But it's not enough to make up the deficit of a new product launch, you know? Sustained service,
right?
And this like online stuff they're trying to do. I mean, they have like rights against the YouTube stuff. You know, if you ever watch anything on YouTube, which if this is going on, you know, you'll run into issues where you know they'll just flag it and say, "Hey, it's ours. You shouldn't be doing that." So,
right.
You post anything Nintendo, they'll flag it.
Oh yeah, but Earthworm Jim, was that Sega produced though, or was that a third party title?
That was a fantastic game.
I don't remember. I don't remember if that was the first or third party title. That was a great game, though. Didn't they try to bring it back on Xbox?
They did bring it back. It was definitely a third party game.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
I think it might have been produced by Sega, but it was developed by somebody else.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, it was developed by Shiny Entertainment and publisher Sega. Yeah, so
okay,
it wasn't
so it was published. Yeah, cool. So what do we think? I mean, the problem is, I mean, I know one of the big talks with the big gamers is that the Wii isn't, or the Wii U, it's not designed for gamers. It's designed for people who play video games, which there's a definitive difference. But is it simply that their games are too casual and with PCs and tablets getting cheap, like that's the thing that we is, it's very casual. They're very pick up, put down. But I don't care if you have a Nexus or a Samsung tablet or an iPad, there are thousands of apps that are free that are just casual games that you can pick up and put down and you can take them with you.
But are they of quality?
Some of them.
Yeah,
I mean, some, but not all. Gotta look. Yeah.
Well, if you got an iPad, you got Hearthstone. I mean, what else do you need?
it's an iPad. Nobody needs one of those things.
Yeah.
Use it as a coaster, for God's sakes.
Yeah.
But I think for Nintendo, the scariest thing is that, you know, they had the highest selling, in the last generation, they had the best selling console, the Wii, and a lot of people got burned by it. I wanted one just to play Zelda. I'm like, but no, I just borrowed someone else's because... They didn't
it
want
was
it.
Worth
they
it.
Didn't use it. Yeah.
So, I liked Zelda Skyward Sword. It was brilliant. I loved it.
Yeah. So
great prequel.
Prequel. I like Twilight Princess better.
Twilight Princess was dark, and that was nice.
Ocarina will forever be my favorite.
Majora's Mask. I don't know why. It's just I love the feel of it.
Yeah. I never played through it.
It was dark as hell. It was like people were dying.
Love it.
Now, am I the only one of the four of us that has a 3DS?
Yes. No, I have one.
Okay, did you play Link Between Worlds?
No,
I didn't actually.
So much fun.
Is
so
it good?
Much fun.
I mean,
it's a direct sequel to the Super ones. NES version, man. Like
so of
Link to the Past.
A Link to the Past, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which
oh,
some
okay,
people
cool.
argue
is it the same island?
I think so. I think
well,
if it's
awesome.
Not the same, it's similar. And you go
like
back.
Dragon Roost Island.
Yeah, you go back and forth between. It's really dumb because everyone knows that Link and Zelda live in Hyrule, and they weren't creative that day. The flip side version, like the other world, is called Lorule. So it's Hyrule and Lorule. But it's like a dark, demonic version of it, and you find cracks in the world, and you go through the cracks, and it flips you over to the other side. And, like, there are certain parts of the map you can only get to in one part of the world because, like, part of Lorule is destroyed, so you have to... It's almost a puzzle to get to certain parts of the map.
Okay, but, I have a question about that, actually. What's the whole premise behind you turning into a stupid flat piece of paper? Because that kind of bugs
That's how you flip. What it is your introductory villain... turns people into paintings. You have this weird dude you meet that gives you a bracelet, and there's something magical about that bracelet that lets, when you get turned into a painting, it lets you pop out. So that actually adds a very large puzzle element to the dungeons, because there are hidden rooms hidden heart containers, etc.
Was it Paper Mario style? I mean,
it was Paper Mario meets Link. It really was, but it was a lot of fun. It was a great story. It was a very good playthrough. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it more than I enjoyed fucking Wind Waker.
Like Wind Waker? Wind Waker was great.
No, I hate Wind
so
Waker.
So big.
It was great.
I know. It was the biggest one.
I will say that the Wii U that I bought my daughter came with a free digital copy of Wind Waker. And in HD, it looks a lot better. I haven't played through it, but I still don't like the art style. I can't stand cel-shaded graphics.
Oh, that's too bad. See, if you hate cell shading, you're instantly going to hate it. It's just nothing you can do.
Well, it's not that I hate cell. It's just that and this is my gripe with Nintendo. We have all this modern technology. Why are you still making my video games look like they're 15 years old?
And then re-release nostalgic. It in 10 years.
And then re-release, yeah. And it is a nostalgia thing. Them. But on the same side, I'll go and boot up like my pixel is shit Final Fantasy VII on my PlayStation Vita.
You make a remix.
Oh, they do. They do. They've been still quoted saying that they are not going to make a remake for Final Fantasy VII until they make a Final Fantasy better than Final Fantasy VII, which they are never going to do. So we're never going to see one.
More than seven, so.
What's that?
Well, and you'll never beat the 10. You'll never beat the nostalgia factor of seven.
You
never.
Would like eight more than seven because you're an emo kid. And that was basically a soap opera in the Final Fantasy world.
It was beautiful.
10. It's a nice story. You know what I liked about eight. Well, I don't want to just insult you and not back myself up. I loved eight for the gameplay. I liked the draw system. I liked the gameplay value where, there was that boss. It was like the second or third boss you faced, right? Where you draw off of them, and you can only get that summon from that boss if you were smart enough to draw it.
Yeah, I like the characters too, but
the gunblade was cool.
Yeah, you'd kill yourself with that thing, though. I mean, like, instantaneously, you'd be dead. Like, I don't know how this works.
Now, 8 had, what was the weapon in 8? Was it, because you had Ruby and Emerald in 7.
I'm forgetting.
Was it?
It's been a while.
Was it Omega weapon?
I think so. I don't know. I'd have to go back and replay it. It's been a long time.
Yeah.
And it's like an 80-hour game anyways.
At least.
Yeah. I mean, I just remember I went to like the ultimate final boss. Is that the one that's like under the ocean or whatever? Or like down in the tunnel? And I did that. But, you know.
Under the that was 7. Yeah, under the ocean was Emerald. Yeah. That one was a lot of fun.
Yeah, I can't keep those games together. I haven't picked up a Final Fantasy since 10. So.
That's so good. I didn't
even do that one.
Ah, 10 was beautiful. The story in that is so great.
Foot Fingers is like 3. It that much. What is actually 6, but for the American crowd, it's 3 for the Super Nintendo. How do you guys, have you guys played that one? How do you feel about that one?
3?
3. It was the, it was 6. Never played it. It was the one with, you had the mechs, and it was, Locke, I think, was one of the characters.
I have no idea.
Yeah, I only played through it once. 4 was my pre-PSX. 4 was my favorite. The one with Sid, they all had Sid, but Kane and Cecil, and you had Rosa, which was the summoner. That was my favorite one. Zeramis was the final boss. PSX era, definitely 7. 8 is my second. 9, I hated the art style. I couldn't stand 9 at all.
I liked 9. I liked 8 and 9. Those are kind of my two.
8 R style I really liked, I'll admit. I never played 9. So
8, I liked what they were going for, but I felt they were a little before their time. Like, going back now, it feels a little dated because they were going for a very realistic look, and I think it was just a little before its time.
Mm-hmm. But, true.
But that could also be...
What happened to Versus?
We don't know. At least I don't know. Did they ever say anything about it?
No, at least I haven't heard anything.
Or is that...
We don't talk about it.
Is that what 13-2 was Versus, or did they scrap Versus for 13-2?
No, I didn't think they were scrapping Versus at all.
Okay, because
I think they might have retitled it, but I know they weren't scrapping it. I can't say I've seen it in the wild. They haven't said anything, really.
Yeah, and they're supposed to be talking, I mean, they were, they're not now, but they were supposed to be talking about 15, so maybe it's gone by the wayside.
Could have been. Could have been.
Right.
I mean, what other RPGs are out other than, like, the Square? I mean, Transistor was kind of like an RPG.
BioWare stuff is on the way.
Witcher 3, yeah.
What's on the way?
Witcher 3. That's more of an ARPG.
It just came out for that.
It looks beautiful, though.
Yeah, it does. It looks fucking brilliant. Yeah. I like the Witcher games. The combat in that is just awesome. So much fun.
And they still manage to sell a lot, and they don't have any DRM, and they don't waste money on advertising.
Yeah.
Damn right.
And they don't charge for downloadable content. They're pretty good people.
That's how you get your games to sell. I'll admit, I bought Watch Dogs from Steam, and it still had to go to Uplay, and then the servers were down on launch day, And it was a headache because the DRM in Uplay makes it so that you couldn't log on to...
You're going to have a bad time.
Yeah. So. I had more fun playing Child of Light from the same studio from Ubisoft as well. And I had more fun playing Child of Light than I did going through all of Watch Dogs, which is really sad. So,
I heard that's like an RPG-ish, isn't it?
Yeah, it's basically like from our fact of JRPGs. It's like it's done in the style of a Japanese, RPG, and it's only 6 to 7 hours. But I thought it was a great game. I had a lot of fun from it, and the soundtrack was great. I mean, I like how all the music is evolving for all the games now, where you have orchestras or whole teams that if a game doesn't sound great, like Among the Sleep or something, it ruins the atmosphere.
Oh, it totally does.
Indeed. Indeed. Really quick before we break to the thing, while it's on my mind, Corey, are you excited about The Last of Us HD remake for PS4?
Oh my God, dude. I'm so stoked. I stole my brother's PlayStation 3 from him just so I could play that game.
I actually haven't played it yet. So,
oh, it's so good.
I didn't have a PS3.
So good. I bought it for what was that? When I was living in Iowa, we had a full system and a huge HD everything set up. And I had bought the Xbox, he had the PS3. And I bought that game midnight and just played it through and I didn't sleep.
So I had actually sold my PS3 a month before it came out.
So that's good.
But that's good though, because now I'll have it in pure HD on PS4 for my first time experiencing it. So,
and the multiplayer.
I never finished it.
I heard the multiplayer was awesome. I didn't get time to do it.
It was so good. The multiplayer is great, super fun. It's like if you're playing the actual game, the gameplay doesn't change at all, and you're just still doing all your same shit. You're playing single player. It's awesome. Right.
I'm curious. I got to cut you off to have Brandon talk because I've heard nothing but massive praise for that game. Why didn't you finish it?
I don't know. I just didn't.
Was it a dislike or just a not enough time?
I liked it. I didn't have time.
Oh, okay.
I would like to finish it at some day, but I probably won't. But
okay, I want to say something real quick about the Metal Gear thing. Just if there's any Metal Gear fans, Kiefer Sutherland. There's none. God damn it.
Not anymore.
Not anymore. Not since it's gone multi-platform.
That's what I mean. It's just it's gone downhill. I don't understand why they changed. Why go to Keith or Sutherland when David Hoyt?
Okay, Hader first off, doing it it's an years. F, not a T. It's Kiefer Sutherland, Kiefer. Not Keith.
I don't care. He's a douche. I hate
you,
his
you,
best you, reasoning ever.
You talk with respect when you talk about Jack Bauer.
Was that 24?
Yes. Somewhere anyway. Kiefer Sutherland is one of the greatest icons on American TV.
Oh, God.
And he couldn't do anything else, so what? They brought back the show.
No. But see, here's my take on that. I've never been a Metal Gear fan, but the fact that you tell me that Kiefer Sutherland is in the new Metal Gear, now I want to go buy it.
That's weird. That's
That's like telling me, that's like, now I want to go get a pair of Beats headphones because Apple bought Beats.
Oh my God!
No, you're doing it wrong.
Slit him.
All right. So really quick, guys, we only got about 10-ish or so minutes left for the recorded show. I wanted to get everyone's opinion because I know we all play it or have played it a time or two. Mojang restricting Minecraft. You can't reward people. You can't charge people to get to your servers anymore. And you can't reward them for donating. It has to be strictly a donation because Mojang is saying that if you are rewarding them, whether you're giving them something for their payment or you're rewarding them for a donation amount reached, they're considering that profit from their game and they don't want people to profit.
That makes sense.
Yeah,
that does. It brings a profit margin from them that they're not receiving at all.
Yeah.
But they don't. Go ahead, Kyle. Sorry.
And I mean, the way I see it is that that's what I've been playing as of late, and I don't think it'll have any impact, in truth, to normal the nominal player, or the people running servers. I mean, you're getting rewarded monetarily for letting people in. That's kind of having your cake and eating it too.
Yeah, so. I can understand that. Do we think that's purely it, or do we think that maybe this is a sign that maybe Mojang is going to start hosting in-house servers, especially with the Oculus. I mean, yeah, we know Notch said no Oculus Rift because Facebook bought it, but he's just being a crybaby. We know we'll get one.
I don't like him to begin with, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you really think Oculus, like VR, I know it's moving in that direction, but I don't know. I honestly don't think that it's going to be a great thing. You know, yeah, it's, you know, a giant thing on your face and it looks great and you get all tipsy, but, you know, it's been around for so long. And at the same time, I tested one. I was at a convention here in Chicago and it was great, but also, you know, it's a sweaty and kind of gross. I don't know if I could do that for like my usual gaming session.
No,
it's a good point.
I agree.
Because, I mean, if you're playing a game for like an hour or two and you're looking around, A, you're getting dizzy, and B, you know, you don't, is it better than a monitor? I didn't have it long enough to figure that out. Is that it's better than just a normal monitor for gaming? I mean,
I feel like with the Oculus, I don't see any like big party people coming in and making a game for it. So until then, like, I don't see it really being utilized.
True.
I think I see Sony's being somewhat successful.
Oh, yeah, they announced one, didn't they? What did they call that?
Sony VR? I don't know.
Yeah.
I had a name.
Someone can look it up really quick. I think it's going to be a novelty. I think a lot of us old school gamers is probably going to be like, oh, that's cool. But that'll kind of be it. I know me. I get really bad motion sickness, so I'm not going to be using one.
However, the next thing that it'd be better if it was paired with something. I know the Kinect has an on-screen camera and can do like point motion sways and stuff. If you pair that with like an internal VR, I think you could get something fantastic where, you know, you're surrounded in this atmosphere and you get to control things around it with like physical movement. I think that would be great. But VR by itself, it's just a smaller high definition monitor stuck to your head.
Right.
But you've seen those videos where the guys have made an actual, it's not really a treadmill, but it's like around your waist, it locks in, and they have like a gun, they're playing Battlefield with an Oculus, and they can run around on this little circular track and just freaking look like they're shooting people, like straight up, and they're running around on this little treadmill thing in circles. Yeah. It's great.
Right.
Yeah.
That has a whole level of immersion.
Yeah, and you're going to get all the fat gamers to lighten up. But again, if your performance is your physical, if it ties your physical performance to like your gaming ability, I think that's unfair. It's done. No,
that's unfair. Like, whatever.
You're like, I can't run more than a mile.
Very true. I think that's it. If I have a monitor strapped to my face and I'm using a keyboard and mouse or a controller, then I don't care. You give me one of those full directional treadmills. You know what? Give me a vest so when I get shot, there are ball bearings that tap my chest so I can feel it.
How cool would that be?
I know. Give me something.
No, wait. That'd be terrifying. Feel pain. Like, that'd be awful.
It would bring paintball into video games. Or it'd bring it would basically be airsoft is what it would be. It would be airsoft.
We'd just live in Demolition Man.
Demolition Man, yeah.
But you'd be, but would it desensitize you to feeling that you could take hits from a bullet because you can't as a person?
Well, I don't know. There are people.
Bullet touches you, you're pretty much done.
Yeah, but we're already in that world.
Who's gonna think that?
There are people who think they can jack a car because they played Grand Theft Auto. So
it's true.
Yeah, and there are people that think they can play guitar because they play Rock Band. I mean, so we already live in that
Rocksmith
world.
Has anyone played Rocksmith? I was really debating.
Actually, yeah. I have. My brother actually bought Rocksmith, and he has a Les Paul. But it works really well. It's surprisingly meant to teach you, so it's slow to get into, but once you start figuring out rhythms, he's getting pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, I think games are moving in a great direction with that, so.
It will be cool to see. I mean, we've been seeing it in racing for years. NASCAR has been using a virtual simulator to train its drivers, so it's cool that we're branching into that next. And you know, we had PS2 had a military shooter game that was based, was Operation Flashpoint? No, not Flashpoint. It was something else. But it was it was based off an actual military tactical simulation, and it was
talking about Full Spectrum Warrior.
Yes.
Oh, I remember that game.
Yeah, that was a good game.
The second one.
Didn't they make another one?
Yeah, but it was bad.
Thousand Hammer.
Yeah, but it was bad.
Yeah, the second one I think was actually published or developed by another studio, whereas the first one was basically it was a civilianized version of the military. Really quick, is there anything else anyone wants to talk about? Brandon, I know you've had a long day. You've been a little quiet. Was there anything that you wanted to bring to our attention or the listeners' attention this week?
I don't think so. Just kind of follow up on the WildStar stuff once I've played it some more.
Yeah, definitely. Let us hear more about that next week. Let me know over the course of the week because we'll go from there. Maybe we can get us on there. Kyle, anything else?
No, I'm pretty good.
Cool. Corey?
I guess one quick thing. If nobody's ever played The Wolf Among Us or has not looked really into it, I recommend it. Because it's a super engrossing story.
We're going to have to talk more about that next week. I remember you said you wanted to mention that, and we've just been tangenting. So that's obviously a good thing, but yeah, we'll have to hear more about that. Cool. Well, you know, guys, I think that does it for episode one. Episode one is a wrap.
All right.
Yeah, so it went pretty well. Kyle, thank you very much for joining us. We hope you'll come on again.
He will.
Yeah, please.
And it was fun. So I want to let everybody know that we're going to have a Patreon coming up pretty soon. We're only on episode one, so we're not going to start asking for money right away. But we're going to have different rewards up there. Like I mentioned at the end of the show, I have a Blizzard gift card that I still got to figure out how to get. I'm going to give it away to you guys. We're going to have little different rewards. We have a couple artists that are working with us, and those will be different rewards there and different tiered programs, some behind-the-scenes recording, stuff like that. I've got t-shirts to sell. Wearing it right here. Anyone wants to rep us? I know you guys can't see my video, but $20. I've got large, extra large, and double X. If you would like to order one, but you are medium or small or anorexic, let me
know.
Shut up,
fatty.
Hi, Amber.
What? Nathan's a fatty. I had to call him a fatty.
Let me know. They're going to be going up on the website soon. But if you need a size larger, let me know when I do my next order batch. I will make sure I get your size. Follow us on Twitter at iGeekStudios and also at IG_GeekAccess. Right now, both Twitters are posting about the same thing. But as this show branches off more, they will separate a little bit. Facebook is facebook.com/inkedgeekstudios. You can email the studio at inkedgeekstudios@gmail.com. You can email the show at ig.geekaccess@gmail.com. And you can email me at ig.nateward@gmail.com. Corey, where can people contact you?
Not many places, but I am definitely on Facebook, and I am going to be starting a live stream. But until then, I have no information for you.
Okay. And Brandon and Corey, we discussed before the show, you guys can basically be found on here, maybe on Twitch now and then. If you guys want to ask.
And I'll have the link email set up in the next week or two. I'm still kind of tinkering with it.
Cool. Yeah. Any links for anybody, I'll provide in the show notes. Until Brandon gets that up, if anyone has any questions for Brandon about WildStar, contact me. I'll make sure it gets forwarded to him. And I think that just about covers it. All right. Well, please subscribe to us on iTunes if you're an Apple user. If not, we are on the RSS feeds. The RSS feed is geekaccesspodcast.com/RSS. If you are on iTunes, please rate us. Please leave a comment. It will help us get up there on the boards. While you're doing that, please bear in mind this was episode one, and we really hope you guys enjoyed it, but we can only get better from here. That's going to do it for today's episode, guys. Next Friday, let me pop a date up really quick. I guess it's not important. It's Friday the 13th. Friday the 13th. That should be fun.
Four games. Let's talk about them.
We're going to have E3 coverage. Maybe we'll do something. These days, cult horror movies are definitely a geeky thing. We'll see what we bring you guys. Brandon will have more about WildStar. I'm sure I'll have some more Watch Dogs to talk about. We'll definitely have E3 to talk about. We'll see if Square is just bluffing us with with the whole no Final Fantasy 15. But all right, maybe. That's gonna do it. Thanks for listening, guys, and we'll see you next week.
Bye. Bye-bye.